Reading with your kids.
Hola, ni hao, konnichiwa, assalamu alaikum, shalom, machaba, morimuliwanji, namaste, jumbo. Bienvenidos. Hi, my name is Jed Lee, and this is the Reading with Your Kids podcast. We are coming to you from the beautiful neighborhood of Reedville in the southwest corner of Boston, Massachusetts. We are so delighted and so very honored that you join us in our mission to help all families grow closer through reading. Please be sure to tell all of your family and friends about the show. Please tell your kids' teachers, their principal, their librarian. And please be sure to subscribe to the show on the iHeartRadio app, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, Good Pods, wherever you find your podcast. Our guest today is Patrice Karst. She is here to celebrate the Invisible String Backpack. Before we invite Patrice into the studio, we want to let you know that this episode of the Reading With Your Kids podcast is brought to you by The Chuckle Wobbles, a delightful book by our friend Prue McDonald. Get ready to enter the wonderful and whimsical world of the funny and lovable Chuckle Wobbles from planet Mirth, where a magical book transports them to planets whose beings have forgotten how to be happy. Their mission? To release happiness within the hearts of those who are a little sad. Join two Chuckle Wobbles, Giggle and Cackle, in their adventures to the sad planet of Mopus, home of the weary, dreary doldrums, where they get themselves into all sorts of trouble. Journey through the bamboozled woods to the mysterious temple, which holds many secrets, including a riddle that must be solved before happiness can be released within the hearts of the doldrums. Do the Chuckle Wobbles succeed in bringing happiness to the doldrums? Do they return home safely to Mirth? Find this out in the fantasy adventure, The Chuckle Wobbles, by Prue McDonald. It's a Reading With Your Kids certified great read. This episode of the Reading With Your Kids podcast is also brought to you by Hunter's Tall Tales, a beautiful book by our friend Rosalie Mass Taylor. Million questions about Hunter's limb difference lead to tall tales, but there's one question that leaves him speechless. Take a journey with Hunter as he faces his first day of school and the endless questions about his prosthetic leg. Will he give an honest answer or make up an outlandish story? A delightful and entertaining children's story about a boy with a disability that will help children understand acceptance, inclusion, and what it's like to be different. Laughter will ensue when Hunter tells his tall tales. A moment of wonder will occur when a child asks a very important question. You don't want to miss this book. It really is wonderful. We recently talked to Rosalie here on the podcast. This is a fantastic book. We recommend it highly. It's a great, great book to have in any family or classroom library. Hunter's Tall Tales by Rosalie Mass Taylor. Join us right now from the beautiful state of California. Our guest is here today to celebrate so much. There is so much to celebrate in her life. First off, we're celebrating her birthday, so happy birthday. And we're also celebrating the release of her brand new book. It's called The Invisible String Backpack. Please welcome to the show, Patrice Karst. Hey, Patrice, happy birthday. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Jed, and thank you for having me today.
Delighted to have you on, and delighted that you're able to celebrate so many great things. I should also mention you have another book coming out soon. It's called Ruby and Lonely. But let's start with The Invisible String Backpack. This is part of a very successful series. Am I right?
You are right. The Invisible String Backpack is the seventh in the Invisible String series of books that has just turned into an amazing phenomena. You know, I wrote the first book, The Invisible String, back in, gosh, it got published in 2000 when my son was just a little guy in kindergarten, and he used to cry when I would bring him to school in the mornings, and he had separation anxiety. So I just told him one day what was obvious to me, which was that we were connected all day long by an invisible string made of love. And it literally stopped his separation anxiety, just gone. So that was it. I knew I had something really special, and I decided to write it as a children's book because all his little friends wanted to hear the story of the invisible string. Do I really have an invisible string, Mom? Do I, Mrs. Karst, you know, and my son was blown away by the whole thing. And anyway, I went to a small publisher I knew. I wrote it as a children's story, and it came out. And then about 10 years ago, and it did pretty well, but it was a tiny, tiny publisher. And then about 10 years ago, it just started to blow up. You know, the military started to use it, and the prison system and foster groups and adoption groups and hospices and hospitals and social workers and therapists. And it just turned into this just amazing, amazing story. And we've now sold 1.5 million copies of The Invisible String, and it's in 17 languages. And the message of love is alive and well. And then that sprung into a whole series of books about invisibles, the invisible string, the invisible leash, about the, you know, our animals when they pass away, and the invisible web, about how we're all connected by love, and we really live in a web of love. And then I did a workbook with Dr. Dana Weiss, who's a PhD in art therapy, called The Invisible String Workbook. Then we did a baby book, a toddler board book called You Are Never Alone, An Invisible String Lullaby. And then the book that's coming out in just a few days on July 11th is The Invisible String Backpack. And that book is about a little girl on her first day of school who has a lot of worries. And she discovers that she carries with her an invisible backpack that is filled with tools that she can use to not only help her through her first day of school, but for the rest of her life. And it's a book to empower children to realize that we have inside of us all the tools that we will ever need to help us.
I absolutely love that. What a stroke of genius. I mean, I wish 30 years ago I had thought of that when my son was crying and inconsolable, letting me know that he didn't want me to leave me with his grandmother, aww, who he loved and adored. But it was just, no, I want everybody to be here together. If I had been able to pull that idea out of my back pocket, that, oh no, we're going to be connected by this invisible string, I think that's such a genius message for kids. And it must be so gratifying for you to know that not only do have families embrace this book, but people who are helping families who've been separated for whatever reason, whether it's military service, whether it's being incarcerated, they're using this idea of that invisible string to help kids and families know that they're connected, and there's this power, this thing called love that can't be broken.
Absolutely. And you know, that even though The Invisible String has become, you know, the number one book for children dealing with separation anxiety, any kind of loss, death, grief, et cetera, et cetera, it's also just a huge book to celebrate love. You know, it's one of the big Valentine's Day books and Mother's Day and going away gifts and graduation gifts and baby showers. So it's really, it's just crossed over into every different world you can imagine. So yes, even though, ironically, there's one page in the book, just one, where the children who have been asking Mom about the invisible string and how far can it reach and where can it go, and Mom's explaining all about the wonders of the invisible string, and there's one page where the children ask, can my invisible string go all the way to Uncle Brian in heaven? And Mom says, oh, yes, even there. And that one page is what turned it into the number one, and has been this status for years on Amazon. It's the number one book for children in death and dying. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, in answer to your question, it's incredibly gratifying and amazing to get these letters from all over the world, literally. I spend, you know, a part of my, of every day answering emails, and posts on my Insta, you know, people reach out to me in my DMs about the fact that The Invisible String and the other books have really, really affected, in incredible and powerful, poignant ways, these families. So yeah, I have a very, very good job. I'm very, very blessed and very, very honored.
Well, that, you know, we have a lot of authors who listen to the podcast, and I'm imagining there are so many that are listening right now and just imagine in hoping that one day something that they write is going to touch people on the level that your book has touched people.
Well, you know, I always tell people, because inevitably, once people find out I'm an author, what comes out of so many people's mouths is, I've got a book inside of me. And I always say to them, well, let's get it outside of you. Let's write it, you know, make it happen. But, you know, I'm not going to give people false hope. It's an incredibly rare thing to have a book actually take off. I know some amazing writers that have written beautiful, beautiful, beautiful books. And, you know, it's like anything in this world, there's a certain amount of just luck and grace and serendipity and magic. You know, Invisible String took off with no advertising, no marketing budget, barely any distribution. It was a word of mouth phenomena. But I tell people, if there's something that you feel, you know, deep inside of yourself, that you have a message you want to give, then do it. But it really shouldn't be for the hopes of grand success. It should be for the desire to share your message. And then if even one person hears the message or reads your book and is moved and changed by it, then you've done an important job, an important work.
I think that's such an important message to get out there to folks that, yeah, selling 1.5 million books is great and it's a great dream. But as you said, it's very rare. It's a unicorn. It doesn't happen very often. But there's still great value in just creating something that is going to touch one kid, one family.
Yes. Yes, it really is. And, you know, in my case, when I wrote the book, I would have been thrilled if I had sold 500 copies of it. Honestly, I just felt like I was directed to do something. I got the message, and, you know, that it turned into the phenomena it did, it was beyond, has been beyond my wildest dreams, truly.
Yeah. Well, I love the idea behind the Invisible String backpack, this idea that kids carry with them, this kind of like Batman tool belt, where they have everything that they need right there on their back. You can't see it, but if you're dealing with anxiety, dealing with bullying, dealing with some kind of challenge, you can reach inside that backpack and pull out the superpower that we're all born with. I think for some kids, just giving them that idea is enough for them to find that superpower that I do think exists inside of all of us.
Yeah, and that's why I wrote the book, because I wanted kids to feel empowered. And we have tools. We have tools. We just need to start to reach inside to find them, because they all live within us. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the most important tools that we have that can't be bought in a store. They are just something that's within us, and we just need to tap in and find them.
Yeah. You know, I'm a really positive guy. I'm one of those annoying glasses half full guys, to the point where people get sick of hearing that. And I also believe that we are all part of this beautiful web of love. But I'm imagining that there are some people out there who might be thinking to themselves, oh, the world is so unfair, and there's this problem and that problem, and why are we spreading this message that you know, obviously there's not everybody is loved, and how can you tell kids that they're loved when there are so many problems out there?
Oh yeah. I mean, that's, That's a really, really good point. But what are we going to do, right? We have to just keep marching forward and into the light, because I don't think there's probably ever been a time on this planet when, if you were to ask the people living during that time, if they thought these were very, very hard times, they would say yes. But as parents and educators and caregivers of children, we just need to remind them that love is the most important thing that there is. And love, as I said before, it's alive and well. It's not going anywhere. And love is absolutely, you know, it transcends time and space. It's the most powerful force that there is. And we all have it. We all have people we love and people that love us. And even though, yes, there's very sad things, you know, I am not the eternal optimist that you are all the time. I get very down sometimes. And I need to read my own books mm-hmm. and remember what's important. I think the reason I gravitate to children's books is that sometimes the more simple the message, the better. Mm-hmm. I don't think we need 400 page, you know, books about the most important issues in life. I think most of what we ever really needed to learn on a deep, deep level could probably be found in children's books.
Yeah.
So I tend to write books, kids' books, about subjects that matter to me. And I know that as a child growing up, I suffered a lot of loneliness, which is why I don't know if you mentioned earlier, but I have a book coming out in September called Ruby and Lonely mm-hmm. about a little girl who has a big problem with feeling lonely. And then one day she discovers herself in the mirror and everything begins to change. And she realizes that she will never be alone because she has herself. So my books all tend to have the theme of love and oneness and connectedness, but touching on important subjects that I think need to be addressed. And a lot of times parents want to shy away from discussions of loneliness or sadness or death, taboo subjects. And I believe the opposite. I believe that, you know, children are very aware of death, for example. They have a goldfish that dies. They hear about a grandparent that dies. They hear something on the news about people dying. And I think the sooner you can begin that conversation, the better. Mm-hmm. And, you know, especially when there's beautiful books that can touch on these subjects in careful, eloquent, gentle, comforting ways.
Yeah, I agree.
Thank God. Thank God for good books. Yeah.
No, I absolutely agree. One of the things that we talk about here in the podcast, anytime we have an author on who's written a book about grief, I always mention that the time to bring this book, and most people think, oh, the time to grab this book is when grandma dies or when, you know, there's a loss in the kid's life. And that certainly is an important time. But I think it works much better to talk about these issues before the tragedy happens, to sit down and talk to your kid, for a kid to know that there is an invisible string that connects him or her to a loved one that's in heaven, whether it's a great grandparent that they've never heard of, never met, you know, but just heard of, or somebody that they might lose in the future. You know, when that time, that tragedy comes, it's kind of like going to the gym. You know, the first time you want to lift up a big heavy weight isn't when you need to do it. It's much better to go in and practice and build up those muscles. And then when it comes time that you need to rely on that muscle, it's there for you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that's the mistake that sometimes make, is to wait until something happens. Like, for example, you know, with the invisible leash, which is my book about our beloved animals and when they pass away. And I know that a lot of parents are getting that book ahead of time for their kids before the beloved family pet passes away. Mm-hmm. 'Cause it's a beautiful book that, you know, that really explains about the bonds of love between us and our beloved animals. Yeah. That exists not only while they're alive, but after they pass away too. So yeah. I agree. Yeah.
And, you know, I don't mean to rain on anybody's parade, but unless your family pet is a sea tortoise that you got when it was an infant, the chances are your dog, your cat, your bird is going to pass away in your child's life. So it's much better to start having these conversations, letting them know that love continues on and can never be broken. As long as we hold it close to our hearts.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. I also want to just touch again on Ruby and Lonely. I love that idea of helping kids kind of combat loneliness by falling in love more with themselves. Can you talk a little bit more about that concept?
Well, yeah, I mean, I suffered loneliness a lot as a child. I came from a very abusive, family home, and I was very alone, and it's a book that I would have really benefited from. I came to know myself and my reflection in the mirror once when I was on an airplane at 30 years old when I was having like a horrible panic attack. And, I remember walking into the little tiny bathroom of the airplane, so freaked out, so sad, so scared. And I looked at myself in the mirror and I saw this reflection of this very sad, scared, small, child, me, my inner child, if you will. And I remember I just started talking to her and saying, "It's okay. I love you. I'm sorry you're scared. I'm here. We're going to be together. We're together. We are going to do this. We are fine. I'm here. I see how scared you are." And I will never forget that moment. There was something about looking at myself and seeing myself in the mirror and comforting that self. And I realized, oh my gosh, I'm not alone. I have me. And that's what Ruby discovers, in her story. She discovers herself and she starts, inviting this alter ego, if you will, that she calls Lonely, to come to school with her and to dance with her and to play with her and to play with her dog with her and to sleep in the bed with her and cuddle with her. And before you know it, Ruby and Lonely have merged into one, and she's not alone anymore. And she realizes that she has her own inner best friend that will be there forever.
That seems like such a wonderful gift, really. It's a wonderful gift to give to a kid, because there are going to be times in our lives when we feel lonely, when we feel left out, whether it's that we don't fit in, we've moved to a new school, we're in a new environment, new dance class, new soccer team. We can't, as parents, we can't fix all the interactions that our kids are going to have out there. We can't protect them from all the loneliness that they're going to experience. But maybe we can help them get through this by introducing them to the wonderful person that they are and helping them become friends with that person.
That's the whole idea, because when you think about it, children have never really learned that concept, or most anyway, that they have themselves. There's something about seeing your reflection in a mirror, and think how many times kids look at themselves in a mirror. They see themselves every single day, multiple times a day. So to be able to give a shout out to that reflection that's looking back at you, like, "Hey buddy, here I am, here we are." I think I'm very excited about this book. Yeah. I truly, truly am. Yeah. I just came back from Chicago. I was at the American Library Association, which is a huge convention of all the librarians and school counselors and teachers from, and regular librarians from across the country and Canada. And the reaction to Ruby and Lonely was really magnificent. And the reaction to The Invisible String Backpack. My books are regarded as, I guess, they're SEL books, which are social emotional learning books, which educators use a lot to help children deal with different issues. Yeah. And I'm just honored and thrilled that my books can help.
Yeah. What a wonderful, wonderful gift to give to kids, giving them the knowledge and the power that that inner loving voice inside of them is louder and stronger than all the negative voices that they may encounter in the media, on social media, on the playgrounds. I'm imagining, Patrice, and I don't know if you've heard from any families, but I know myself there are many books that I read to my kids that were written for kids, written to move kids, that moved me when I was reading it to my kids. As you were talking about that invisible string that connected the kid to their uncle in heaven, I'm imagining the first time or the first through 100th time that I would have read that to my kids, that I would have teared up a little bit.
Oh, yeah. I hear that a lot from people that write to me, that you know, there's a lot of tears that start flowing.
Yeah.
Because when you hit on deep truths, something gets released inside of you, and tears are one of those beautiful little waterworks that let us know their hearts have been touched.
Yeah, wonderful. We should let everybody know where they can go to find out more about the Invisible String Backpack, and be ready to greet Ruby and Lonely when it comes into the world.
Well, yes, thank you. Obviously, the books are all available on Amazon and wherever you get your books. I also wanted to say that The Invisible String is now in September going to be released in a gorgeous hardback that matches the paperback. Originally, it was published with another publisher, and that issue is going out of print. So now it's going to have the same beautiful art as the paperback, and that comes out in September. People can find me on my website, patricekarst.com, patricekarst.com. And yeah, wherever you get your books, Barnes & Noble, your local indie bookstores, and it should be a really fun summer because a lot of exciting stuff is happening.
We've had a really wonderful time speaking to the author of the brand new book. It's called The Invisible String Backpack. Our guest has been Patrice Karst. Hey, Patrice, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me, Jed. It's been a joy.
Please be sure to join us for the next episode of the Reading With Your Kids podcast. Our guest will be Lauren Chaitoff. She'll be here to celebrate 108 awesome yoga poses for kids. I'm hoping I can do like 3 of them. Listen in. Find out how many you can do. And find out how you can have fun doing yoga with your kids. That's the next episode of the podcast. I want to thank the folks who made today's show so wonderful. Plus, we're going to start by thanking our guest, Patrice Karst. Please be sure to check out The Invisible String Backpack. Also want to thank our sponsors, Prue McDonald. Be sure to check out the Chuckle Wobbles. And we also want to thank Rosalie Mask Taylor, the author of Hunter's Tall Tales. I want to give a big thank you to my team, Fatima Khan, Rory Grady, Monica Rivera Sosa, Ann O'Leary, Soji Franklin, Madison Darris. I want to thank my beautiful wife for all the support she gives me. Most of all, we all want to thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. And as always, thank you so very much for taking the time to make the world a better place by reading with your kids. I'll be looking for you in the next edition of the Reading with Your Kids podcast.